Phenol has a wide variety of uses, and it's a precursor to many things like plastics or pharmaceuticals. Phenol is normally a white crystalline solid, but it's susceptible to oxidation in air, and old phenol tends to be a little bit discolored. When phenol is oxidized by oxygen in the air, it tends to form para-benzoquinone, which has a yellow color. However, phenol is also capable of undergoing a polymerization reaction. The polymer that the phenol forms has a brown or black color. In air without a catalyst, the polymerization is really, really slow, so it's only a problem with old samples. Just by the color of the phenol that I have here, it's pretty easy to tell that it's heavily contaminated. The brown color indicates that we have polymerized phenol present, but we're also going to have benzoquinone and other oxidation products. Luckily for us though, it's pretty easy to clean up the phenol, and all we need to do is a quick distillation. The phenol in this video was used to make anisole, which I just posted a video about. In a future video, I'll use this phenol to make a plastic called Bakelite. Right now, the phenol in this bottle is a solid chunk, and to get it out, we're going to have to melt it a little. Luckily for us, phenol has a pretty low melting point, so this can be easily done with some hot water. I don't show it here, but I let the bottle sit in hot water, and using a metal spatula, I was able to loosen things up. I dumped the loose phenol into a glass funnel, and I blasted it with a heat gun to melt it. I didn't use a huge funnel, so I couldn't add everything at once, and I had to do it in something like 3 separate batches. As the phenol was added, it got progressively blacker and blacker, and I think this is because when I originally melted the phenol and added it to the bottle, a lot of the polymer sank to the bottom. Anyway, I was eventually done melting and adding everything, and I was left with a flask of super dirty black liquid phenol. I removed the funnel, and I melted the phenol on the side of the flask just to try to clean things up a little bit. I then went ahead and set things up for a short path vacuum distillation. The setup is almost the same as a simple vacuum distillation, except we don't include a condenser here. A normal cold water condenser would cause the phenol to freeze in it, so it's really not a good idea to use one. It is an option to include warm water in the condenser, which would cool down the hot phenol vapors but not freeze it, but I don't really think it's worth it. The benefit of a warm water condenser would be fewer phenol vapors passing into your vacuum pump, but if you set up a proper trap, that shouldn't really be an issue anyway. To get a better separation and a potentially cleaner product, you could also use a fractional column. We use a vacuum distillation here for 2 main reasons. The first one being that it greatly reduces the boiling point of the phenol, and it also prevents the phenol from reacting with oxygen. I do have a feeling though that it's possible to distill it without a vacuum, but I've never really tried this, so I can't really comment on the purity or the quality that you'll get out of it. Once under vacuum, I turn on the heating mantle and the stirring, and we can get the distillation started. It doesn't take long before it's boiling quite nicely, and we start to get some stuff passing over. It should be noted that water and phenol form an azeotrope, so any water that's present is going to co-distill with the phenol. For what I plan to use it for, I don't need anhydrous phenol, so this is okay, but if you do need absolutely dry phenol, you're going to have to use a slightly different process. I assume that the procedure would involve using some sort of drying agent before distillation, but I'm not exactly sure of the details. The heating mantle was occasionally adjusted to maintain a good rate of distillation, but for the most part, we're on autopilot. To condense as much of the phenol as possible, I set up a ghetto paper towel condenser. I place a cold towel on the apparatus, and it actually works pretty well. Near the end of the distillation, I've collected a very nice amount of crystal clear, colorless phenol. I was very excited about this, but unfortunately disaster struck and I distilled things too far. I should have stopped it earlier, but by letting it go on a little bit too long, I started to collect some yellow stuff. I stop the distillation immediately, and in the distilling flask, you can see we're left with some reddish brown or black goo, and unfortunately, our receiving flask is tainted a little bit yellow. This really isn't the end of the world, and the contamination level is really low, but it's still a little bit disappointing. With that being said, the two ways to have prevented this was to either stop the distillation earlier or to use a fractionating column. A column probably would have prevented the contaminants from coming over with the last bit of phenol, but I don't really know for sure. If we look at the bottom of the receiving flask, we can see that the phenol's already starting to crystallize, so it's probably a good idea to transfer it to a bottle before it completely solidifies in the flask. The phenol is poured into a Pyrex bottle, and we wait for it to crystallize. Before it completely solidifies, it's a good idea to break things up. This way, once things have completely solidified, we'll be left with a jar of loose phenol and not a solid chunk. Our final phenol product is an off-white crystalline solid. Pure phenol is as white as the paper below the jar, but unfortunately, the contaminants make it a little bit yellow. I did consider redistilling everything to clean up the phenol, but I decided that it really just wasn't worth it. The amount of contamination is extremely low compared to the crude stuff that we started with, and for what I'm using it for, it really shouldn't have much of an impact. In my last video, I asked you guys to give me the mechanism for the first step of this reaction. I thought it was kind of a tough question, and I was happy to see that a lot of you were able to come up with something. Before I go over the answer I liked the most, though, I want to make it clear that the exact mechanism is not known. I did some research, and I couldn't find any real experimental data, so we're mostly just theorizing here. There were two main mechanisms that were proposed, and I'm going to quickly go over both. The first one is my preferred one, and it was submitted by the Wise Salmon. I looked over all the comments and submissions, and I think he or she was the only one to suggest this type of mechanism. To start off, the aldehyde is protonated, and the partial positive carbon of the carbonyl is attacked by the nucleophilic anisole ring. The hydrogen is picked up, most likely by water, and its electrons are donated back to the ring to regenerate aromaticity. The hydroxyl group that we form is then protonated under the acidic conditions. The methoxy group of the anisole again donates electrons to the ring, which results in the kicking of the water molecule. A chloride ion from hydrochloric acid comes along and attacks the double bond, and the aromaticity of the system is regenerated. The only issue that I immediately see with this mechanism is that an aldehyde isn't the strongest electrophile. The methoxy group of the anisole is extremely strongly activating though, and it might be able to make up for this. Here's the second mechanism that was suggested by a lot of people. This one in particular was made by Timothy Morrison. Other people submitted some very nice chemdraw mechanisms, but unfortunately I can't show them all. Like the other mechanism, this one also starts with the protonation of the aldehyde. In this case, however, we get an attack by the chlorine and the formation of an alkyl halide. The alcohol is then protonated and it leaves to form a carbocation. The carbocation is a relatively good electrophile, and the activated anisole ring can attack it. The attack by the anisole ring is activated by the methoxy group, which donates its electrons, but I think he forgot to show it here. After the electrophilic aromatic substitution, the extra hydrogen is picked up, and the aromaticity is regenerated. There are a few errors in this mechanism, but I'm only going to address what I see as a major problem. In part 1, after the loss of water, we form a carbocation, but this is a primary carbocation. Primary carbocations are not very stable, and the likelihood for this to form, especially with an electron withdrawing group like chlorine attached, is extremely low. If this carbocation were to form, we would probably get a hydride shift, and the positive charge would move over to the secondary carbon. With a positive charge on the secondary carbon, we wouldn't form our desired product. Because of my major concern with the second mechanism, I think the wise salmon has the best idea. So now that we've seen these two possible mechanisms, I want to know what you guys think. Do you agree with me that the first one might be the best, or do you think that the second one is still good despite my concern? Like I said before, I don't really have a concrete answer for this, and I'm looking mostly to just have a discussion. On a side note, I'm thinking about removing the whole reward thing for answering the questions. I honestly like the idea of giving out prizes, but it's just really hard to do fairly. People who submit their answer later could potentially work off previously submitted answers. To remedy this, I said that the best answer first would win, but this kind of ruins the fun for people who can't watch the video immediately after it's posted. I feel like the idea of having to race to give the best answer first is kind of not good either. And having to choose just one person to give a prize to out of 5 or 10 people who might have had just as good of an answer is kind of just not fair. With that being said, I'll still give out the beakers to the people I featured in this video because they promised it in the last one, but in the future, I'm pretty sure I'm going to stop. Besides the whole fairness issue, I feel like my entire purpose of asking a question was to get discussions going in the comments, and offering a prize kind of detracts from this purpose. Anyway, the next video that I post is going to be on the production of ammonium metavanidate. As usual, I'd like to thank everyone who's supporting me on Patreon. Everyone who supports me with $5 or more will get their name at the end like you see here. I know I've been saying it forever, but I really am trying to work on other tier rewards, and to add more rewards to the $1 and $5 levels. Anyway, these are the videos that I've filmed, and the ones that I plan to film. If you have any suggestions, please let me know in the comments.